Welcome to BW Hot Wires. We have with us a very esteemed guest, Mr. Rafiq Somani, Vice President, Ansys Inc. Mr. Somani, thank you so much for sparing your time with BW Business World, sir. It's always a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. My pleasure too. And always good to see all the good work you guys are doing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Very honored to hear from you. As you know, this pandemic has, impacted everybody. There's the hotel industry, travel industry, tourism industry. Even our industry got impacted. Media industry
was worst affected.
It's an open secret. So, has there been any impact in the industry that you operate in, or the industry that you cater to? If yes, would you be willing to share that with us?
Yeah. So, I think a very relevant question. So thankfully, Ansys cater to different kinds of industries. So at one end, we are catering to automotive, which is a traditional automotive industry. Then there is aerospace and defense industry. There is industrial equipment industry. There's a consumer industry. There's a semiconductor industry. And to a certain extent, the small and medium companies, suppliers, academic. So we healthcare. So we cater to all different kinds of industry, and clearly some of the traditional industries have got impacted the most. Naturally, everybody knows the aviation, commercial aviation in special has got impacted the most. So our big customer like Airbus and Boeing may not be, or even including companies like GE, which is our long-term, very, very long-term and very strategic customers, may not be able to do some very strategic progress in some of the futuristic project which they were working on. Same is true true to automotive industry. So traditional automotive products, I'm not talking of autonomous and EV, those have got impacted. So if I talk of these traditional industries have dramatically got impacted and affected by COVID and pandemic, there are some industries which have started doing quite well, including FMCG, agriculture, which India had a good monsoon, healthcare. When I say healthcare, it includes both pharmaceutical and medical device companies. So we are seeing a lot of spurt and growth in the startup community, companies trying to come up with innovative products and services. So these are some of the industry sectors. Semiconductor continues to do very, very well, because while we are working from home, everybody is trying to have digital products like laptops and mobiles and all the technologies. So semiconductor is doing very, very well for us globally and in India. So I think there are some industries which have got negatively impacted. Some of the industries have got positively impacted, and some companies have been very smart to come out with a new strategy, and they're working on it.
Self-driving technologies, autonomous vehicles, and also electric vehicles and all. So are there any change in those macro trends? And is that and your functioning and all also changes accordingly? If you can talk a little bit about that.
So Abhishek, very good question. Coming back to my earlier point. So if you look at the traditional automotive industry, mostly related to IC engine, they have shown quite slowed down. And of course, in India, the automotive already was impacted much before the COVID had coming because of some taxation and the new Euro norms. But what we have seen, if those traditional projects have come under pressure and the timelines have got affected and investment have got affected, the same companies, and I'm not just talking of India but global perspective also, they are continuing to invest very heavily on autonomous and their electrification projects. In fact, one may see a trend also, not only globally but in Indian companies also, that they may not pressurize their some of these new verticals, including ADAS and EV. They may hive it off as a separate entity to continue to have that focus. So I think we have continued to see good customer interaction and traction, not only globally but in India, on especially EV and autonomous. And of course, we have suddenly seen a pent up demand because for traditional products also. So it's good news for automotive industry because people have the aspiration and also want to be safe, so they want to use their own mode of transportation. So it's good to see the traditional automotive products also doing well.
As you know, the transactions are going contactless. They are getting virtual. And touchless experience is the name of the game. So how are some of your core business areas like 3D printing, additive manufacturing, etc., getting impacted? Or should I say they are getting further accelerated because of that?
Good.
Yeah.
So I think, it's a very, pertinent and important point, and as I said in my opening of my talk, that digitization is becoming very, very important, and a lot of companies will have to work remotely. And when you're talking of remotely working, and just let's talk, because we are talking of automotive, and we can talk about different industries also. Testing and prototyping is very, very important in the traditional industry. Now, companies, because of the pressure and because a lot of people are working remotely, one may not be able to spend a lot of time on testing and prototyping. So just an example, and if you're talking of AV and ADAS car, to certify it and run safely on the road, it has to be tested 8 billion miles. That is almost like 15,000 trips to moon, and it's impossible in today's time to do that physical road testing. So all these companies will do virtual testing on simulation, and maybe some corner cases, or they want to get some certification and all for compliance reason, they may have to do some physical testing. So that's automotive industry. A lot of other complicated engine products are there, or industrial products are there. Again, you may not be able to make a lot of expensive prototyping and testing for all these products because the pressure. You talk about electronics products like mobiles and laptops and other ones also. Everybody is under tremendous pressure on time to market and coming out with new products faster. And with this pandemic and remote working, digital prototyping or virtual testing will become very, very common. And Ansys has come out with very unique technologies, what we call as, we have tied up with Microsoft Azure platform, and with help of unique technology which we have developed, we call it VDI, which is Virtual Desktop Infrastructure. Any engineer working from home, from their laptop or a low-end PC, connected to Azure cloud, can get the power of the workstation what they get at office, and can do a simulation and testing sitting at home. Yeah.
So also there is another interesting trend on Make in India getting further accelerated with Atmanirbhar policy. So as global majors including Apple are ramping up their manufacturing, or for that matter, assembly plants in India, do companies like this stand to gain, or is business as usual? Your thoughts?
No, I think it's a very, very positive news for India. And one of the things which we are working, not only for international customers, if you look at my customer base, 50% of if you're doing over 100 million business in India, 50% of them may be for international companies like Cummins, GE, Honeywell and all, but 50% of our focus is on making sure that Indian companies become more Atmanirbhar. And I can keep going on giving a lot of examples. So because of the geopolitical nature and what has happened with the COVID, if more work is coming to India, naturally manufacturing, it is good news for India and good news for Ansys also. Already, already I can say with confidence that India is already the simulation capital of India. So all the major global companies are there. They have their centers where they do a lot of simulation in India. And you know, a lot of these companies, maybe 50 to 60 or 80% of their simulation or new product innovation and product design is happening in India with help of Ansys. So if the manufacturing also comes, you know, it'll be very positive. We will be able to help a lot of the Indian companies you know, become the suppliers, and a lot of startup companies will be able to. We have a very unique package for startup companies, which is very, very price competitive. We offer them cloud solutions. So without having any expensive HPC and workstation environment, which tends to get obsolete, we are able to give all small end suppliers and startup companies some startup bundles and cloud technology solutions, yeah, for them to easily get into business.
So also, sir, you just mentioned about working with startups and all. So, and the government is talking about MSMEs are the next growth levers of the economy. So how do you perceive these, apart from these startups, how do you perceive these MSMEs? Are they the next growth frontiers for you? If yes, if you can talk a little bit about that, why do you think so? They cannot, I mean, afford all the technologies at this juncture. So, I mean, is there not a challenge to cater to them? If you think
so, Abhishek, it's a paradox question. First of all, I will, in a way, disagree that startup companies and MSME don't invest into such technologies. And, I will tell you, I can tell a lot of examples, our CEOs, startup CEOs and MSME, medium and small scale industry, and they're one of the fastest growing market for us in India. And I can give you some percentage stats. I will not give you the revenue. In 7 years since I'm leading Ansys in India, our revenues for MSME has grown 15 times. And it is one of our fastest growing segment. So I will answer it in two ways. One is the MSME are very ambitious, and I'm very proud of the second generation CEOs where they are ready to adopt technologies and they are very bullish about future. So maybe the first generation must have done traditional manufacturing, but the second generation CEOs are quite bold and they believe in technology, and they're ready to invest quite substantial portion of their revenues and turnovers and invest. It's an investment for them, and they don't see it from the cost perspective because they get a very quick ROI. And if they want to come out with cutting edge technologies, then they will need technologies like that. Having said so, parallelly, Ansys is trying to come out with offers and solutions and packaging, which is quite competitive for them to start up. So, it is between two. I'm very proud and happy to say that our MSME, especially the second generation CEOs of a lot of the MSME companies, are very, very bullish on technology. And that is one of the fastest growing segments for us in Ansys.
So it seems that you're working on a lot of groundbreaking solutions which are next generation in nature. So with the advent of new technologies, many of the jobs become redundant. So the government is talking about creating jobs. So how do you ensure that you are not annoying the government and you are in your plans and your future course of action is aligned to the government's objective of not only making in India but also creating jobs?
So I think this is an off-track topic, and I can speak on it for 2 hours because I do a lot of lectures.
Heard your lectures.
Thank you, Avish, for bringing this. I mentor for a lot of young students also, and one of the things they are worried is the engineering courses or the studies they are doing, and when they pass out, that technology or that field will become redundant. Yes, because of technology, a lot of jobs become redundant. But this question question of, you know, technology will create more jobs. So, you know, you go back to history and centuries back, you know, when the man and the human being started making, you know, the first farming equipment or the wheel, you know, this question comes back, but you know, you have to upskill and reskill. And you know, even when in India, you know, when I was young, there was a lot of chaos, and especially the banking industry was, and the ATM, when they came, they said, oh, the banking jobs will be lost and all. But I think what has happened with the coming of computers, more and more jobs are getting created. So the banking clerk, he was just doing cash in, cash out, which ATM is doing. Now he's upgraded and become a relationship management or fund manager and all. So same thing, you know, technology like simulation will create more jobs. And because of the advent of new technologies, the only thing is youngsters need to upskill and reskill. And for every job which is lost, I feel, you know, two new jobs are getting created with the advent of technology. So I totally agree. And I am in line with the government policy that all companies should create more jobs, and we are creating more jobs. And I think we are running very interesting programs in academic. We are running a lot of created a lot of content on Ansys, you know, to kind of make IT engineers and young engineers learn this simulation, because you know, traditional jobs may not be available. Hence, we are doing a lot of free high-end trainings to a lot of youngsters. So, you know, more and more jobs will be created than jobs lost because of new technologies like Ansys.
Okay. You spoke about your technologies, you spoke about getting jobs and all, but you're a high-tech company. I'm sure you run an R&D center. If you can talk a little bit about that, and are they working on domestic market, or are they working for your global market? What kind of activities are carried out? Is India an important innovation hub for your global operation?
Yeah. So I think I'm very proud to say that being an Indian, you know, and I think we should be proud of that Indian companies and Indian engineers are very, very valued. And when I said my earlier statement that India is a simulation capital of the world, you know, and there's a famous quote from the ex-G CEO that they came to India for prize and stayed back for quality and innovation, correct? So India is just not, you know, price competitive, but I think more interestingly for companies like Ansys, you know, some world-class engineers are available, which do some really good work. And I'm proud to say that, you know, we have three key development centers in India, one in Pune, which is our major development hub. And we have development happening in Bangalore, and we have some development happening in Noida. So Ansys India plays a very, very strategic and very important role for developing all the new technologies and product for Ansys globally. So, and these products are use the development which happens in Ansys product is used by global customers internationally by everybody. Apart from that, India is also a technology hub for supporting all the global customers also. So if you talk about some Tiger team, you know, which you know, knows the Ansys technology in and out, and if you want the best support for aviation or automotive or ADAS or electronics or semiconductor, you know, those engineers are sitting in India. So apart from development, the Indian engineers are globally supporting and mentoring a lot of engineers globally. Yeah. So I'm very proud to say that, yeah, being an Indian.
Okay, sir. Some of the key partnerships or the technological developments that you're working on specifically for the Indian market, if you can talk a little bit about that. You've already answered that the some of the industries that you're catering actively towards medical research and all and pharmaceutical healthcare, but some of the partnerships, if you can talk about that, some of the key technological developments, like if you which has been like something groundbreaking that you're working for India or you have developed for India?
Yeah, so I think because under NDA, I cannot name the projects, but very clearly answering your question directly, we are working with most of the auto OEMs on a lot of key futuristic EV projects for India. That is one of, including startups, from four-wheelers to LCVs to two-wheelers also. Yeah, we're working very, very strongly and very, very actively with every major OEMs and every two-wheelers and three-wheeler companies. That is a major one. The second, the major one is with aerospace and defense. And there are a lot of projects of national importance and a lot of projects which we have to indigenize, become Atmanirbhar. And there are a lot of futuristic aerospace and defense projects India has got. We are very, very actively working with Indian scientists on all our aerospace and defense customers. The other ones is naturally a lot of industrial engineering companies, consumer companies, healthcare. I told about, we are working with a lot of healthcare, pharmaceutical companies and medical devices companies, which is of strategic importance to India. That is our major one. I already spoke about startup. We are working very, very closely with a lot of startup companies. And something which is very close to my heart is academic. I believe, and this is a long-term investment for Ansys, so we may not see the fruits of it now, but I strongly believe, and because of my and NGO background, I believe in making the young generation, give them this new technologies and tools. So that is one project I'm personally driving with my team to make sure all the top, not only the top IITs, but the second tier engineering institutes and all engineering and ITI institutes are using Ansys technology. They have these tools. We are almost giving them this technology at no cost, at nominal fee. And we are educating the engineers for future. Because I strongly believe in Make in India and Atmanirbhar initiative. And unless and until, it should not be Make in India, it's design and innovate in India also. So design and innovate in India will only happen when our engineers are using the current generation technologies, which will help them to design futuristic project. So we don't have load and dependency on international companies, and we don't pay millions and billions of dollars to foreign companies for IP and technology. Yeah.
Spell out the roadmap that that lies ahead of Ansys, and I mean a little bit about your operations in India. How much are you earning, and will India be your biggest growth? Will be your biggest market going forward? We'll talk a bit about that.
Yeah. So first, let me talk about. Let me speak about the international Ansys. So currently Ansys is already last year we did 1.516 billion. And if you
billion euros?
Ansys, Mark, billion euros? US dollars. 1.5 billion US dollars.
Ansys with India, right?
No, globally. And then I'll come to India first. I'm talking of globally. Okay. So 1.5 billion plus last year. And we are growing double digit. The market cap of Ansys is $27+ billion. If you look at the stock price of Ansys in the last 6 months, even in COVID times, it has grown up $100 minimum. So we are growing. We have a very ambitious goal to become a $5 billion company very soon. Current market simulation market is about $6.6 to $7 billion. But by 2026, we expect this market to triple. And if it triples from current 7 billion mark, then we want to have a major pie. And if you look at Ansys history, in the last 50 years, we have done over 28 28 acquisition. In fact, yesterday, even in this pandemic time, we have made a definitive agreement to buy a very expensive technology called AGI, which is used for satellite communication and telecommunication and satellite launch and aerospace and defense thing. So even in this pandemic time, we have been buying. In the last 2 years itself, we bought 6+ companies. So we are very, very ambitious. We are clearly market leaders globally, and we'll continue to be market leaders and continue to innovate. We are miles ahead as far as technology is concerned and revenue is concerned and market cap is concerned vis-a-vis our nearest competitor. Yeah. So, and coming back to India, it's a reflection of what is happening globally. We are also growing very, very aggressively in India. In fact, if Ansys growth rate is globally, double digit growth, then Ansys India is growing double digit plus, at least 50% more points. Meaning we are adding at least growing 150% or 1.5 times more than what our global growth rate. So India is a very very important market, not only for the Indian company's point of view, but because, as I said, India has also the a lot of international support, international simulation work happens for all the top companies in the world. They have their development centers in India, from automotive to aerospace to industrial, you name it. Everybody has their big center in India. Either they have their direct centers or they are working with some engineering service provider like Infosys or TCS or Wipro.
So safe to assume that India will be among your top 5 markets in the next decade?
Yeah, it is one of the fastest growing market. And the only thing we have to remember, I don't want to claim top 5. The only thing, and I want to make here a statement to government and our industry. If you look at the and this is where, if India has to come out as a top economy in the world in manufacturing, we have lost the manufacturing battle to our neighbor, and of course a lot of geopolitical situation is there. We are capital for services and IT, but if you have to become, make in India a real economic trust, and Indian companies need to invest in R&D. And I will mention, you go to UNESCO World, UNESCO website or any website, India spends only 0.7% of our GDP in R&D. Vis-a-vis Korea, 4.5, our neighbors, 3.5%, Japan, 2.8%. Every country is spending more than 2.5% of their GDP on R&D. And India is spending 0.7%. So I think I think we need to be a little bit ambitious over there. It's a collective call. The industry and the government has to spend, if this Atmanirbhar and Make in India slogan has to become a reality.
Thank you, Mr. Somani. It was a pleasure interacting with you. It's a privilege. We wish you all the best in your
Thank you very much.
And we look forward to interact with you again. Thank you so much.
Sure. Thank you. And it was my pleasure to hear. Yeah.